QueryDSL is a popular framework that provides you a Java API to create queries for relational databases and other data stores. If you're familiar with JPA's Criteria API, you might think that it does the same as QueryDSL and that you don't need to learn about another framework. But I recommend you give QueryDSL a try. It's not as verbose as the Criteria API, and your code will look very similar to the SQA statement you want to execute. That makes QueryDSL a lot easier to use. Hi, I'm Torben Janssen. If you're new here and want to build incredible efficient persistence layers with Hibernate and Spring and all types of other Java persistence-related stuff, subscribe and click the bell to get new videos every week. And also don't forget to like this video if you found it helpful. By doing so, you are helping me to reach more people with it. QueryDSL provides you with a type-safe, fluent API to create SQL-like queries in Java. Due to static typing and the usage of a generated model representing your entity classes or database tables, these queries are less error-prone and much easier to refactor than the typical string-based queries required by JPA and Hibernate. It also integrates very well with Hibernate so that you can use them together. QueryDSL's model follows the same idea as the JPA meta model. At build time, an annotation processor scans your entity classes. It generates a model class for each of them, which you can use to create your queries. To add the annotation processor to your project, you need to add a dependency to QueryDSL apt to your pom.xml file. Let's get into the IDE and give it a try. QueryDSL's annotation processor generates a class for each entity. Each class is located in the same package as the entity class and adds the prefix Q to its name. The generated class has an attribute for each entity attribute. We will use these later in this video to reference entities and their attributes while defining our queries. QueryDSL not only supports JPA and Hibernate, it also supports multiple backends and provides a separate module for each of them. The one that integrates QueryDSL with JPA is called QueryDSL JPA. You need to add it as a dependency to your project. After you generated the model and added QueryDSL's JPA integration, you can use the model classes and QueryDSL's JPA query class to define your queries. One of the main benefits of this approach is that the provided API is very similar to the generated SQA statement. Before creating your query, you need to instantiate a JPA query object. When doing that, you have to provide a reference to the current entity manager as a constructor parameter. That integrates QueryDSL with your current Hibernate session and its database transaction. In the next step, you can use the methods of the JPA query class to define your query. As you can see here, the methods name are self-explanatory and the Java code looks very similar to your SQL statement. In this case, I call the select method with a reference to a QChessPlayer object to create a query that selects ChessPlayer entity objects. QueryDSL uses Hibernate to execute the query and map the result. Due to that, the return entity objects are in the lifecycle state managed. You can use them in the same way as any entity objects loaded via a JPQA query or the entity manager's find method. I use that same QChessPlayer object to define the from and where clause of the query. In this example, I want to select all players with the first name Magnus. The first name attribute of the QChessPlayer class is of type StringPath. It's one of QueryDSL's model classes. It provides type-specific methods to create expressions that you can use in various parts of your query. In this case, I use it to create an equals expression that compares the first name attribute of a chess player with the provided string. And after you defined your query, you can call the fetch or fetchRun method to execute the query. When calling the fetchRun method, your query has to return none or one result. The fetch method returns the result as a list. As you saw in the previous section, implementing an SQL query using QueryDSL isn't complicated. And that doesn't change if your SQA statement gets complex. The names of the methods provided by the JPA query class are self-explanatory and often match the SQA keyword. Here you can see a query that uses multiple join clauses and where expressions to select a chess game played by two given players. You can see here I use two Qt chess player objects. One represents the player with the white pieces and the other one the player with the black pieces. That is necessary to ensure that QueryDSL uses different aliases for the two join clauses so that we end up with a query with two independent join clauses. You can use QueryDSL's JPA Query Factory class to define SQL delete and update statements. You can do that in almost the same way we created the query statements in the previous section. But I don't recommend doing that if you use QueryDSL with Hibernate or any other JPA implementation. It's much easier to implement these operations using entity objects. Hibernate then also manages first and second level caches. These don't get updated if you implement your query or removal operations using QueryDSL. So better keep it simple and perform the required changes on your entity objects. For some use cases, you need to define your query dynamically at runtime. You can do that using JPA's Criteria API. But most developers, myself included, complain that it's too verbose, hard to read, and obscuring the generated SQL statement. QueryDSL provides an API that's much closer to the defined SQL statement and integrates well with Hibernate. Thanks to its annotation processor, you can define your queries based on a set of model classes. Each of them is strongly typed and represents one of your entities. That avoids almost all strings in your code, makes it much easier to read, and increases type safety. Okay, that's it for today. If you liked today's video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe below. Bye!